Good afternoon, everyone. Let me introduce myself a little bit. So I did my bachelor's in computer science from IIIT Gachibowli, and then I went to do my PhD and master's from UT Austin in Texas. And after that, I joined a company called Fair Isaac. They used to do work in financial data, credit card fraud detection, credit rating, things like that. And we used to be part of their research group, which used to do what they call blue sky research, which is advanced research in different areas, text, vision, things like that. So after 8 years of that, I moved to India and I was part of Yahoo Labs for some time, then went to some bank here. And for the last 4.5 years, I've been with Google in Hyderabad. So with that, what I'm going to do today is I'm going to share a lot of my learnings from all that time looking from a visualization perspective. So, I generally talk about the same kind of things but with one theme in the focus. So today the theme is visualization. And before I talk about that, I wanted to say a few words about the conference. So, knowledge sharing is a very important aspect, right? And it happens beyond the premises of within the companies or within the colleges, right? And I think the more these kind of conferences happen, people from different industries come together. Some of them want to learn, some of them want to teach, and we all come together and talk about different topics. So we really need a forum like that, and it's great that companies like Hasgeek and others are providing that forum, which is independent forum for people to come together and do these things. And I attended the last conference. It was just mind-boggling. I was just completely amazed by the kind of people who attended the conference. They were geeks. They knew, what is MapReduce and what is Hadoop and all this great stuff. And they were very eager to learn new things and, share what they have learned. So a lot of excitement, enthusiasm, a lot of talent I saw. And, I could just see the birth of a new Silicon Valley in Bangalore. And most such events are going to make that happen, right? So really encourage you all to participate in some form in these kind of events, which is going beyond your college education and things like that. So with that, welcome to this conference. Hopefully, you like what you see and you're going to participate in such things more. All right, so today I'm going to talk about a picture is worth a billion numbers. You've heard of this phrase, a picture is worth a thousand words, right? I forgot what it was. Picture is worth a thousand words, so I just use that to talk about picture is worth a million numbers. And this is about million numbers are coming from the data that we are collecting and what we are going to do with it, right? So visualization is a very important part of understanding the knowledge, the data, the information that is coming to us at such a huge pace. So it's a very important area of ongoing research, ongoing new technologies and algorithms being developed. So it's a very important area to know about. What I'm going to do is I'm not going to tell you about a lot of visualization techniques. It's not a tutorial on how to do visualization. What I'll show you is a lot of real-world visualizations that we have developed in our company and how they can be used to make interesting decisions about the data, find interesting insights. So you'll see a lot of real-world applications of visualization and what we can do, and we'll touch upon very few techniques here and there. But this is just to give you a sense that this is an important area, it's a practical area, and it involves a lot of work and it has a lot of value. Alright, so how many of you like football games? Right? Are you guys watching it? So who do you think is going to win?
Germany,
okay. Anybody else? Argentina, alright. So I'm completely not into it, so I have no idea. But what I'm doing is I'm trying to introduce this idea of visualization, and this is not what I mean by it. Right? This is not visualization. Right? So we'll talk about another visualization, which is somebody sent me this link recently, so I'm going to use that as a way to explore some ideas. So somebody has come up with this list, and I think they've done that early on, maybe. So this is a list of property. If you just look at this as it is, it's not very appealing, right? You're just giving me a list of possible countries that are going to win. And but they came up with a very beautiful visualization of this whole thing, right? And this is just to give you a sense of how I can talk about a complex thing in a very beautiful way. So what they have done is for each group, they have first and second, and then there are going to be matches between them, right? The winner of this and this and all that, and this data is known, and then they will all go to the final. So you see how they visualize the tree, right? In this space of, it's a very small space of only so many teams, but the idea is see how visualization makes it really very interesting. Let me tell you how they did the numbers. So what they did was, they said, okay, click on any of these, so Brazil, and they come up with this probability of winning as you go along each of the matches, right? So you can come from here or from here. If Brazil is second in the group or Brazil is first in the group, what is the probability that they need? So it's like traversing the tree from each node to the group, right? So it's a beautiful visualization of a very useful set of things going on. And just to give you a premium into what visualization can, right? All right, so let's start with the talk in general. So obviously we all have heard this cliche, right? We are, you know, drowning in data and starving for knowledge. We have way too much data being collected today. If you look at gene sequences, remote sensing, right? Every time you swipe a credit card, you generate a data point. Every time you sell a stock, write a book, or a pattern, buy stuff, or all that, right? So data is being generated at a pace which far exceeds anything humankind has ever seen before, right? And it's way out of grasp of any single individual to even take one field and go and say, okay, I know all the data in this field, right? It's just impossible, okay? So really, what do we want to do with all this data, right? We can't just collect it and store it. It's a waste of space. So what do people do with this data? They want to make a lot of decisions on it, right? So if I have your credit card swipe, I want to know whether it's a fraud or not fraud, right? If you have, any other kind of, if you're giving me a query, I want to tell you what are the top 10 results I'm going to show you. So we are trying to make decisions out of data, right? So that is the paradigm we are going to use, which is how to make decisions from data. It's not just something to be stored in a database and queried. It is more than that, right? You plan businesses for. You plan how your airport routing should be. You know, you plan how, what coupons to send to people. You plan where to put the next movie theater in the city. You plan a lot of things based on data, right? So, we will talk about that a little bit to give you a sense of how visualization helps in this whole scheme of things. So if you want to look at data on one side, decision on one side, so from data you generate a lot of insights and we'll see some. Then you generate some features, you build some models, you make some predictions, and you get some feedback. So think of one example. So for example, if you look at web search, right? So from web search we generate a lot of insights, like is this a local query? If I say Hyderabad preschool, I know it's a local query, you're looking at certain kinds of results, right? If I say name of the movie, I know that you might be looking for the release date or book ticket, right? So there are a lot of insights there. We can derive a lot of features like keywords, other things, right? We can build models. So in web search, you are building an information retrieval model, top 10 results for the query, right? And using these models, you can make the prediction and sort all the pages, billion pages on the web for that query, and that's a decision that you want to show this page there, this page there. Are you going to show images on the top or video on the top, things like that. All these are decisions. And based on the click that a user does, you get a feedback, right? I showed him 10 results, he clicked on the third one, so maybe he does not like the first two. And if millions of people do that for that query, that means the third result is a better result, right? And that's the feedback, and we use that feedback all the time to improve search quality, right? So understanding one at a time how we do this, I don't want to go into the details of this. What I want to talk about is how visualization helps in all this. Okay? So visualization really helps us in understanding what the data is like, right? So how many market segments do I have in my customer base, right? All kinds of things. So we'll show you lots and lots of examples of these kind of insights in different areas. How do you analyze features? How do you interpret these insights? How do you make decisions? How do you track feedback? In every stage of this process, you can use visual image. Okay? So that's what we'll talk about. You'll see how interesting it can get. So before I get started, let me talk a little bit of philosophy. And this is one of my favorite, this is not my favorite, this is the world's favorite guru on visualization. And we'll look at one of his videos, and then we'll continue from there. So let me.
See the nuances and all the rest of the story around it. when you look at these, it's accessible. When it translates data from something that's complicated to something simple, when it communicates a message that otherwise would have taken somebody hours to digest and find in an instant. My deepest interest lies in the boundary between data and culture. Data are measurements of something. In very many cases, that is some things that we're talking about are human systems. We're dealing with data systems that are larger than anything that humans have ever built or experienced before. And these are really large systems. Things happen within them that are emergent. For example, aging shot footage from airports, or pretty much every airport in the world, and then air travel data as well. So the central idea was to show people that every time that you're in an airport, you are standing on the surface of a system that is almost compressed to comprehend. Any given time, there are more than a million people in the air. And so there's another purpose of data visualization. There's revelation, which is show us something that you've never seen before. This is for me much more exciting. Anybody can visualize data in the cells using the bar charts. For me, it's about showing them something in this kind of blue staring frame that they can interpret. So I show them some pieces of the picture. And the idea is that they can sort of stand back from that and watch the task for a little bit and come out of it with some deeper understanding. Part is leaving it open to interpretation. Part of it is also not really knowing. I don't have some masterful understanding of this system that you don't. I have some ideas about how these systems might be changing and how they might be growing and how they might be important for culture and society. And I want to share some of those ideas with you and maybe you can put together something that I wouldn't think.
I think in general audiences are a lot smarter than a lot of people think. So it's not know your audience, it's respect your audience and really know your content. That's what you should be knowing. The reason that we look after truth and goodness and beauty will look after us. We want to see to learn something, not to confirm something. We usually see to confirm things. It's very compromising, right? How can we see not to confirm? To see what to learn.
So, you know, he talked about very interesting things, right? So he keeps thinking visualization as some kind of a hocus-pocus thing, but he talks about some very interesting things, and I'll keep quoting him because he's kind of a very big inspiration for a lot of people in visualization. So he says, respect your audience and know your content, right? So it's not about the color scheme on your PowerPoint slides. You understand, right? Then he talks about look after the truth and goodness, and beauty will take care of itself. And we'll see what that means in a lot of visualizations that we'll show. Okay. And to me, this is a very, very important part that he said, how can we see not to confirm but to love? How can we see not to confirm but to love? So, you know, I'll show you a lot of examples where this will come in. So one of the other things he mentions is often the most effective way to describe, explore, and summarize a set of numbers, even a very large set of numbers, is to look at a picture of those numbers. Okay? So I'm just trying to motivate this idea of visualization through a lot of things that he has said. So let's talk about why visualization brought. So if you look at one way of looking at data, one way of interacting with data is to learn some models, to build a predictive model, right? Let me predict card fraud, let me predict success of this, let me recommend a movie, let me predict the thing. One is to predict something, right? So we are doing a lot of things, and what we are doing there is really addressing what we call a first order of equivalence. What I mean by that is lack of knowledge. First order of ignorance is lack of knowledge, which is I don't know. I know what I don't know, right? I know that I don't know where the next Pizza Hut is or what time it opens. So I know that that is what I don't know, but I know how to find it. I can do the right query or something and I can find it, right? So here is something I know that I don't know. What is the next level of interaction with the data? And that's where visualization comes in, which addresses what we call the second order of ignorance, which is lack of awareness, which is I don't know what I don't know, right? So what I don't know is, let's say there's a new Pizza Hut that opened up next door, maybe I don't know that, right? And I don't know that I don't know that. So this is a recursive thing, and that is where visualization really crops up, okay? Now if you are an open-minded data scientist, right, what are you going to do? You're going to go after these kind of unknowns, right? You're not going to say, I know I have five customer segments in my data, customer base, let me force to build a clustering with five cluster centers, right? What do? You let go and say, you know, hey, find me however many clusters there are, right? That's when you need to know how to do these kind of things, and visualization comes in very handy, right? So keep this philosophy in mind. We are trying to address the second order of ignorance, and I'll show you a lot of examples of what that means through a lot of examples, okay? So let's start with the very basic, right? Let's start at the beginning, a very good place to start. I don't know if you know that song from The Sound of Music. So we'll start from the very basic, and you know, if you ever take a machine learning course, this is what we call the first data set in machine learning, which is the iris flower. And this was created by, I think, Fisher a long time ago to understand how to, how to discriminate between these three kinds of flowers, right? So there are three kinds of iris, and what he did was he made these observations about, you know, the four different features, and he had 50 examples of each flower. He measured all these things, and there are four classes and 50 examples of each class. And now let's see what we can do with this most basic kind of thing and how we can use visualization to understand this data. So I'm going to start from the beginning, take you all the way up. Alright, so in terms of machine learning language, you can say this has three classes. There are three kinds of flowers. There are four features, right? Petal length, sepal length, petal width, sepal width. And there are 150 examples. So this is what we call the original data set for machine learning. And if you look at the visualization, the most basic kind of visualization is a scatter plot, right? We are used to two-dimensional views, right? Three-dimensional we can still do, four-dimensional we can't imagine. So the best thing to do is take two dimensions and do a scatter plot. So here we have two of those dimensions, right? Petal length, petal this. And I can color code these with a class label, and you can immediately see some structure emerging, right? You can see that, hey, one type of flower is very different, and these two types of flower are very similar to each other, right? So if you go back, you can probably see that these two flowers are quite similar to each other, right? And this flower is very different from these two types of flowers, right? And you can see that structure emerging in, you know, all these visualizations, that one flower is very different from these two, which look more similar. See, so instead of giving you the 150 numbers and all the four numbers, if I showed you this picture, it is far more instructive. Right? So you can immediately see how to understand data. Scatter plot is the first basic kind of visualization. Okay? Let's look at the next one. Here is an example of handwritten digits. So imagine the postal service is trying to route your letters automatically. Right? In order to do that, they need to read your PIN number. Now if a human reads a PIN number all the time, it will take a long time to put it in different buckets. But if a machine could read a PIN number, this is handwritten, it will be a very nice automated system you can do, right? So that need led to the emergence of research in handwritten digit recognition. So what they did was they collected a lot of samples, about, you know, tens of thousands of samples of different digits, and people write the same number in so many different ways. So it's a very classical machine learning data set that everybody uses. What can you do with this case, right? Visualization on this. So here, you know that this is an image data set. Can I not take the average of all the pictures of each number, right? Take all the zeros, take their average, and see how they look like, right? That's an interesting visualization. to understand the data, this is an interesting visualization. I can also look at the average of the whole thing, and this is how sort of the embryo looks like, you know, like average of all the 9 digits look like. And you can see that, you know, if you remove certain things, you will go to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So a very beautiful visualization to show you how the average looks like and how the digits emerge from it, right? All right. The next kind of visualization is projection methods, right? You've all heard of physical components and all that. So here we talk about, you know, if you have data in two dimensions, what is the most dominant dimension in which there is variability? What is the less dominant direction? And this is what we call a Fisher principal component, and first and second and third and fourth principal component. So you have a data in high dimensional space, let's say 200 dimensional space. You can't see 200 dimensional space. You need to project it on some two dimensional space. How do you project it? There are so many options, right? Think of it like a torchlight on one side and a screen on one side, right? You can project it in so many ways. Does that make sense? So you have the data cloud here, and you're trying to project it in so many ways. What is the best way to project? This question has infinite answers. What is the best way to project? Depends on what you want to find in it. There is no single answer. So this is one of the best ways, which says, show me where the data is very variable, right? So imagine the data is like this. I put a screen like this and torch like this. I won't see much, right? Everything will look like a dot or a small cloud. So I don't see the variability or, you know, structure in the data. But if I put a torch and a screen like this, I see a lot of variation, right? And that is what it means by principal components, which is what is the most dominant direction with a lot of variability, right? So in this case, you know, this is the right direction. So this is what we call the first principal component, second principal, right? So you can imagine in 200 dimensional space, you can have the first 200 ordered principal components and you can solve. So this is an example of the same MNIST data, 10 digits on a two-dimensional projection. So there are 10,000 points. Each point is in a 28 by 28 space. So it's a, you know, 734 dimensional data projected onto 2D and color-coded by class label, right? So you can see that there is some structure, but a lot of classes are kind of mishmash, right? You can't see much. Okay. What about another reason to project? Is this the only way to project? So let me give you one more example of why you want to project. Let's say you have a two-class problem, right? And you want to know, you want to see the structure in that. If you project on this direction, what will happen? You know, you can't distinguish between the two classes, right? Let's say this is fraud and not fraud, or spam and not spam, or relevant document, not relevant document. It's a two-class problem. And now you want to understand the data. So what is the right projection? If you project this way, you are going to get a both the classes are mixed on top of each other. Although this would be a good direction for PCA projection because the variability is very high in this way. But it's a very bad thing if you need to do discrimination. But if you project on this direction, right, you put the light on that side, and you see, you will clearly see that there are points in the two classes. So you understand what I mean by there is no right visualization. It all depends on what you want to get out of the data. If your data has no class labels, if it has no distinction between this class and that class, you can just do PCA. But if you do have class labels, you go to what we call a Fisher projection, right? And therefore, you know, we keep building on this idea of how we keep getting more and more insight with more and more complex kinds of visualization. Okay? So this one gives you the variance in the data. And and this one maximizes the separation. Alright. So here is an example. Now tell me, I'm using these three examples, class 0 in digits, class 3 and class 8. These are all very similar looking things, right? 3, 8 and 0. So I have three classes out of 10, and I'm trying to project them on 2D. Now, maybe you can tell me which one is a better projection in terms of it's telling me more structure, more separation between the classes.
First one,
right? So this is the Fisher projection, and this is the PCA projection. Okay, this is a projection on 10,000 times 3, 30,000 points. I'm just sampling them just to show you, but you get a structure. So you now can see the structure emerging from this kind of thing. Okay? Let's look at one more example. This is class 5, 6, and 8. Again, very similar looking classes, 5, 6, and 8. And again, you know, this one has kind of a better structure than these. This, right? Look at how the PC. So visualization depends on what you want to get out of, right? What kind of structure you're looking for. All right, so we talked about multivariate data. It's a very basic one-on-one kind of thing on visualization. Let's do something more interesting with it, okay? Which is what I call multidimensional. So let's do a thought experiment on smell. Let's try to visualize smell. How many of you are into perfumes and things like that? Nobody will say that, that's okay, right? So there was this, I don't know if it was a thought experiment or a real experiment, but imagine you want to understand the structure of smell. We understand the structure of visual data, right? We have RGB, we can put a pixel in one of these RGB coordinates. So we understand the space of vision, right? We understand the space of sound, right? We can do Fourier transforms and create these orthogonal dimensions. What about smell? We don't have a space to put a smell in, right? So it's a very interesting problem. Let's think about how would you do it. Any ideas? How would you visualize smell? What kind of data will you collect in the first place? Right? Very hard to think about that, right? All right, so here is a beautiful example of how we can take something as abstract as smell and create a visualization of smell, okay? I won't create one because we can't do it here now, but so this is what they did, which is, they said, okay, let's get all these people who are good at smelling things, right? I don't mean those people, but the real people, okay? And they are good at smelling things, so they can tell you how far away two smells are. That's all they can tell you. They can't give you a point in a space, but they can tell you this smell is similar to that smell. This smell. So what they do is they take two smells, and they give it a score between 0 and 1, right? So they'll take two smells, smell them, and say these are very similar or less similar or very different ones, right? So now, this data is really a matrix of distances between smells. Okay, so you have 200 smells, perfumes, 200 perfumes, and you can create a matrix of smells by taking the average score of those two. Understand? Now, this is how we have to be creative about certain kinds of data. So maybe, for example, gene sequences, right? Gene sequences, you can't create a visualization for a billion long gene sequence, right? Or a document, right? Because different number of words, you can't create visualization just like that. So you need to be more creative about it. It's not a simple multivariate data with so many features and so many data, right? So there's a technique called, so once you have this kind of matrix, right? Which is distance between pairs of things, you can actually create a visualization. And this technique is called proximity preserving method. So what they do is they say, okay, let me assume that the points are in some high-dimensional space. There is some distance between a pair of points. I want to project them into a low-dimensional space such that if this distance is high, this distance is also high. If this distance is low, this distance is also low. Right? So it's a one-to-one projection, and then I'll show you some equations and how to do that. But that's the idea. So what they can do is they can now visualize any matrix given to you as distance between things into a two-dimensional point. So the idea there is that two smells are close to each other or far from each other if the number in the matrix is small or large. You understand? So now we are able to visualize smell. Right? Don't tell that to your wife that I'm able to visualize smell. That would be very interesting. Yeah? You can visualize all the perfumes and stuff like that. Now imagine you want to do the same thing in different domains. So if you have relationship between things, imagine you have two products in a retail store that are sold together more often than random, right? Then what happens? So you can visualize your thing in the same way, right? You don't have a space or a point in some space, but you know how two points go up, so you can create a graph and you can visualize it. So this is an example of one of those graphs. You can also visualize things like people on a social network, how close they are to each other, right? You can visualize all kinds of pair-wise things, right? Two authors writing similar papers and things like that. So we'll see a lot of examples of that in this. So here's the best example I commonly show, which is we created this visualization based on retail data. So the idea is if two people are buying product A and B together more often than random, then that becomes a stronger number in the matrix. And if other two products are farther away, that becomes a smaller number. So imagine, you know, bread and butter will have a strong correlation, and milk and TV is going to have a weak correlation, right? And this is all coming from the data. And once you have the data, you can use this technique called multidimensional scaling or proximity preserving visualization to come up with a 2D map. And the idea of the map is again the same thing, which is two things are close to each other if the number is very high, right? Yeah, or if two things are far up, then the number is low, right? So this could be used as a way to do store layout in a store, right? You can say, hey, how do you lay out the store? And based on what people are buying, you can redo your store. Within each department, you can again do the same thing and re-lay out the store. Okay? Here are some other beautiful visualizations people have created. This is on the gene network, human genome data, right? They have gene expression data, and they're able to see what genes correlate with what genes, right? So this is a graph data. And there are different kinds of gene groups that they have found based on this kind of visualization. This is a graph visualization on author collaboration, right? So who is the most important author in the field? And how many people collaborate with that guy? And how many papers they write with that guy? So you can color code this and you can see what are the dominant experts in different fields, right? Based on co-authorship of data. Okay? So here's the visualization of tags. Here, what I'm showing is what makes the central theme of this collection, right? So this is the central theme, and these are all sort of peripheral things in that group of tags, right? So this is also a graphical visualization of communities, okay? You can do this with tag communities or product communities or people communities. It's a visualization of that, okay? Okay, this is one of my favorite examples. So here what we did was we wanted to understand the customer base of a retailer. So imagine a large retailer like Reliance or Walmart or Facebook, you know, Flipkart or something. Imagine they are all over the country and they have a lot of customers, right? How do you understand the space of all customers, right? So what we did was we said, let's create a similarity between all pairs of customers based on what they buy, right? And then let's create some clustering. So these are 50 clusters nationwide for that retail customer. And how do you interpret that? So we looked at what are the top products that this group of customers buy. So these are, you know, DVDs and TVs and, you know, these are DVD kind of customers. These are Xbox and PS2 and GameCube kind of customers, right? And look at the proximity. These are more of geek kind of customers. They have internal hard drives, graphics, PC, CPU kind of customers, right? Then these are customers which buy a lot of appliances, right? Home appliances like washing machine and all that. So these are all customers, and what we can do on top of it is there is a structure to this space. Three types of structures I'm showing. One is, you know, what do they buy, where they are related to each other, and then I can color code them by how many customers are there and how much revenue do they generate from, right? So this is, in one picture, you can actually see the entire space of all your customers, right? And that's another form of visualization. So then what we did was, this is an example of how we can use this visualization to understand what is going on in this store versus that store. So that was created for the entire country. And now, we're going to do this for two stores. So we picked two stores, and we'll tell you what the stores were. And we saw some very interesting differences. We saw that, you know, some of the clusters were very different, right? The two pictures look very different in terms of revenue and segment size, right? So what it means is, in this store, there are lots of people in this segment, and so they generate a lot of revenue here, and they generate some revenue here, but they generate a lot less revenue here, but here they generate a lot of revenue in this store, right? So we saw that there are two different kinds of stores, and what happened is we realized that, remember, these are customers in the DVD and game kind of area, and these are customers in the appliance area. And then we looked at the stores, we turned out this was a store near one of the universities, so you have this kind of behavior. And this was a store near a rich, posh residential area, so you have these kind of customers. You see? So the same visualization, when you put snow against snow, you can get some very nice insights. And what they did was, based on this kind of insight, they laid out this store differently than this store. Right? So as soon as you walk in, here they will put these kind of things near the front or cash counter. Here they'll put this kind of stuff, the appliances near the cash counter. Right? So now you see how we went from data to visualization to an insight and to a decision. Does that make sense? And it's very hard to do when you look at 100,000 or 100 million customers and their tables. Okay. Alright, here's another one of the very interesting examples. How do you make recommendations better? So imagine that you bought these two products, Car Deck and Car Mini Disc, right? And we recommend these other products to you, right? Audio and activations of radios and other things. So these are very scores. So if I use this score as it is, I'm going to recommend the top products, right? Obviously, I'm going to recommend the first product in the recommendations. But if I did this, if I looked at this picture along with this list, this is what comes out. So this is these products, right? The center product. And this is the top product, which is the first guy. But if I look at this product is not connected to many things. So even if I recommend this product to the customer, he'll buy this and go away. But if I recommend this product, which is lower on the recommendation list, I'm going to land this customer in a place where he would want to buy other things also. Does that make sense? So decisioning is not based on this first order ranking system. First order, this one dimensional ranking doesn't mean much. And if you want to improve your quality of decisions, you want to look at some of the things beyond that. And then you can probably make more useful decisions than, right? So that's what this slide is about. We use this to improve their overall sale as opposed to the sale of the first product in the recommendation list. Okay? So there's a difference between predictions, which is the recommendation score, and the decisions that you take. And they need not be directly proportional. Right? We'll see more examples of that. Alright, so let's look at another example from the financial domain. Okay? So this is where a lot of banks are trying to understand the space of their customers, right? What kind of customers do I have? And how do they do it? So let's imagine that a bank is able to create scores for every customer. This is a risk score. That means if I give you a loan, will you pay back or not? Probability of default is a risk, right? Attrition means, if I increase your interest rate, will you move to another bank or not, right? Attrition, right? Credit score, behavior score. So let's say they have four scores, and if I show them this large table, it doesn't mean much. How do you convert this table into a beautiful picture that can tell them a lot more? And the table, you can only look at, let's say, 20 rows at a time, but you have 10 million, 100 million customers, right? How do you see the big picture and make some interesting predictions on it? And let's say they also have two metrics. How much revenue this customer generates, how much profit this customer generates. Okay? So what we've done is we've created a visualization called, using the same ideas of multidimensional scaling. So we have said, okay, we're going to create a topography. Topography is like a map, right? Let's say you create a map of India or a map of something. And then you can overlay the map with anything. Like on the map of India, you can overlay anything, right? Population density, weather, right? Crime rate, all kinds of things you can overlay on top. So think of creating a topography and an overlay. And for the same topography, you can create multiple overlays. So what I'm going to show you is some of that, but before that, some philosophy. So, like in one of the things they said in the video, it's very easy to see the individual bar charts, right? So I can take each of the four dimensions and look at their histogram on by themselves, and it will look like this, right? You've heard of that five black men who look at the elephant differently. Some people say this is that, this is that. This is what happens when you just look at histograms. You're looking at the data from one perspective. You want to look at the joint space in an interesting way. So PCA is one of the ways, Fisher is one of the ways, this is one more way, right? So what we've done is we created this space, and we saw something very interesting that, oh, there seems like a structure emerging in this space, right? So let's look at what that means. So let's go over the process. We start with the data, we sample some of the points, we don't take all the points, then we create the topography, right? We look at, we try to cover all the kinds of points. So I want to include very rich people as well as very poor people because the distribution is very different, right? I mean, imagine the distribution of wealth in the world. So obviously, we don't want to sample based on what is the normal distribution. Otherwise, I'll not get the really rich guys into my sample, but that's important too, right? So I create a topography, and then I can overlay anything. So here I'm giving you an example of overlaying the revenue. So if I look at the revenue, this group of customers who fall in this part of the space don't generate much revenue, they generate a lot of revenue, right? So you get a nice insight. Then you say, what are these customers, right? Let me go and see what they look like. Then you can drill down into your customer base. So it gives you a big picture of the whole thing. And then you can also look at trajectory, which means if I take these customers and if I make a decision, let's say I increase their credit limit, then these customers will move to a different place in this space, right? So they'll start spending more money, they'll stop paying their bills on time, right? They'll behave in a wrong way, and they will move either to this side or that side of the space. So customers are not static things. It's not a point in space, right? All right. So again, some equations just to scare you. Not to scare you, but what I'm saying is the message is, these pictures are not coming because I'm an artist and I know how to draw beautiful pictures. They're coming from serious maths behind it. Right? That's the point, right? So we use this kind of technique to do this kind of work. So here, what happened is we looked at different kinds of overlays. So we looked at how do we understand this space, this block that looks like this, what does it really mean, right? So we say, okay, let me overlay the rating, customer rating. So these are very high customer rating people. These customers have very good credit rating. Any bank would love to give them a loan, right? These customers have very poor rating. So that's what we understand. Behavior score, so these are four scores that I use, the four columns. Revenue score, I get a lot of revenue from these guys. But the rating of these guys is good. So this is the dilemma that banks deal with all the time, which is, I don't want to take too much risk. If I give loans to these people, there is a lot of risk involved because their rating is low. But these are the kinds of guys who actually generate revenue for them. Right? If you pay your bills on time, the banks are going to hate you. Because you pay your bills on time, they're not making any money on you. Right? So that's the idea. So they want to do something here, but they don't know how to do it. And they know that there is one group of customers, if they move in this part of the space, they're going to move to another bank or quit, right? So this is how this visualization gives me the lay of the land. Now we're talking about 1 million customers in one picture. And how the whole space looks like. This is what we call the big picture. Right? Okay? So now let's look at one of the overlays, which is the density overlay. So same thing. There are two groups, so let's try to understand what this group looks like just using visualization, right? So we start with this group. Let's say you're a manager of this big bank, right, all over the place, and you want to understand what is going on here. So you say, okay, overlay something on it, right? So let's overlay bank card utilization, which means if you have lots of credit cards, what percentage of your credit limit you are actually using? So these people are using very low credit limit. I mean, they have, let's say, credit cards worth of 5 lakhs limit, but they are using, let's say, 1 lakh or less, right? So, but these guys are almost using all of their credit. You can see the correlation of this with the revenue as well as the other things, right? Then we looked at percentage payment to balance. So these are different features, right? These are additional features. So we said, oh, these guys pay almost 100% of what they are due to pay. These guys don't pay, they pay the minimum balance, right? So that's the kind of correlation space there. Then this is age on card. So how old are the customers? When was the first credit card issued to them? These are kind of new customers. And these are the guys who are also ready to get right. Remember the attrition score is high here. Okay? And then we looked at something very interesting, and this is where the new insight came. We looked at the number of mortgages. Mortgages means how many loans you have. Car loans, home loans, education loans, right? So we looked at how many loans you have. It turns out that within this region, which is a high credit rating region, there are two kinds of customers. One have very low mortgages, and one are very, they have high mortgages. And both these guys are good customers, okay? And the reason is that these guys are the guys who just got a job, and who just bought so since they have a job, they have a good amount of money in the bank, so they get a good high rating. And these guys are the old timers, they are retired people, they have paid all the mortgages, you know, they have no more credit to be taken. So they are also, they have very less mortgages, zero mortgages, right? They have no more loans, they have paid off. So both these are good groups of customers which have high credit rating, and you can do something different for these two groups of customers. You can create different policies for these two groups of customers. So you understand how visualization is giving me a lay of the land, and without doing any complicated clustering or anything else, I can see a lot of things visually with these overlays and make a lot of decisions. Okay? Any questions so far? Alright. So here's another interesting thing we saw. We said, okay, let's look at a group of customers who are here, right? And here.
Can you switch off the, because it's buzzing in the speaker. Can you switch it off and then on? Just the other mic. Buzzing in.
Hello. Okay. Does that make sense? Does it make a difference? Okay. Okay. So what we did was we said, okay, let's take a group of customers who are here. Let's make a decision on them. So let's make a decision to raise their credit limit. And let's follow them for 6 months and see what happens, right? So obviously remember, customers are dynamic things. A point in this space is not a customer. It's a customer at any given time. Okay, it's a behavior. It's a combination of the four scores. It is not a particular customer. As the customer changes, he moves to a different place. So, if you look at customers here, some of the customers move to a higher risk area when we raise the credit limit. And some of the customers move to a lower risk area, right, as we raise their credit limit. So you can actually visualize what happens, the feedback part, right? We talked about the whole cycle. We saw insights, prediction, modeling, we talked about feedback, right? Feedback is what happens when you make a decision, how do you monitor that? So you can also visualize your feedback and see what happened to those customers, right? Now you imagine you created a rule. Let's say the rule is, if the guy got married and, you know, he got a new job, increase his credit limit to by another 10%. Let's say you created a rule out of some thinking, right? Now you want to know how well the rule is doing. So you put those customers, you give that, apply that rule to some customers, and see what happens to them after 6 months, right? So you can use visualization to see what is going on, and then you can learn what is the difference between this group and this group of customers, apart from the rule. You know, the rule is the same, so it was applied to the same field, but what is the difference between customers who moved up and moved down? Let me use that as a classification problem, positive customer, negative customer, and redo my rules. You understand? So then you can say, okay, the rule is not enough, I need a better rule to make decision about this. You understand? So how we go through the whole set? Alright, so let's talk about text data. And text data is also a very interesting kind of thing, because it's all over the place, right? You have text data on the web, on Facebook, on Twitter, on all the enterprises, all the papers that are published, all the patents that are written. So text data is all over the place, right? One of the hardest things in text is how do you understand text the way humans do, right? And humans can read only a small amount of text data, but they can understand it very deeply. But computers can read, consume lots of web data, but they don't understand it the way humans do. So how do we bridge that gap, right? So visualization is one of the, I'll show you how to visualize text data and what we can do with that, okay? So let's start with a simple exercise. What is this word?
Important.
Important? Right? I mean, it took you a little bit of time to figure that out. Okay? Now tell me, what is this word? Same word. But because it is in the context, it's easier to interpret. Right? Now let's read this paragraph. Right? So the idea of what is the meaning of a word, what is the word you expect after I say this word, right? There's a whole philosophy around how to understand language and how does the brain work, and this quotation kind of summarizes this. It says you should know a word by the company it keeps. What are the words before it and after it are going to tell you what is the meaning of the word, right? If I say the sentence, Apple filed a suit against Orange. Now, we know what orange is, right? We know it's a color, we know it's a fruit. But when I say it in that sentence, you think, oh, it must be a company or a person, right? But actually, it is a company in France. It's the Airtel equivalent of India. And there is a company called Orange. And if you have a, you know, sentence like that, how does your brain understand the meaning of all the words, right? File could mean file with an arrow, with this thing, or file your nails. Suit could mean what you wear, right? Or a lawsuit, or a suitcase. How does your brain make that connection? That this is what the meaning is. So meaning of the text lies in the context in which the words are. Right? Context gives you the meaning. Okay? So what we do is we use the same kind of philosophy to say, let's do clustering over some text. So what we did was, for every word, we created a high-dimensional representation, and we looked at the words in the neighborhood, and we moved these words around, such that words that co-occur in the same neighborhood are together, right? So it organizes the space of all points. Now, if you do clustering on that, it kind of tells you that, oh, this is a very meaningful space, right? If you look at regions in the space, they are sort of semantically very close to each other, right? Toxin, carcinogen, vegetables, basil, all that, eye and all that. Now, the question is, how do you visualize this? You still have clusters. You can't see your entire corpus. So what I'm going to do now is show you a whole bunch of such visualizations on how to see the corpus, what we can do with it. Okay, so here is a visualization of a news corpus. This is a news from one of the countries that CIA is interested in. And they want to understand something in this news, which will come in the next slide. Now, what we did was we took all the news articles in the last 10 years emerging from that country, and then we put them on a two-dimensional map. This is called a self-organizing map, which is a form of clustering which can sort of put things on a two-dimensional surface so that things that are nearby are similar in meaning. Remember, we talked about the meaning of a word. Orange, does it mean apple, you know, this or that. So in the meaning space, this space is organized in a two-dimensional space again because we are able to visualize two dimensions. This technique is called self-organizing maps. So then what we did was we said, okay, let's do another clustering on each of the cells. And then we realized these cells are actually telling me something. So this is mass destruction, international relationships, diplomacy, verbal conflict, religion and politics, freedom, justice. See, the topics are also very similar, right? In some part of the space. This is banking, government, election, meetings, news media, arrest, detainment. This side is transportation and infrastructure, military technology, right? Agriculture and commodities. So you see how the news is kind of, now you know the lay of the land, right? You know what are the different topics the news might be in, right? Okay, what can we do with it? So then what we said, well, let's look at one of the cells, and let's look at the words that are nearest to it. So what we've done is, imagine I have 100,000 words in a high-dimensional space. I put them on two dimensions. Now each part of the space is in one cell. And two cells are close to each other if those parts of the space are close to each other. Okay? So now, if I look at one cell, these are the words in it. So this is chemical, biological, bacterial, radiological, germ, munition. If I look at this cell is talking about Richter scale, seismology, tremor, aftershock, quake, earthquake. So see, what we have learned is some kind of a mass destruction through warfare or through natural disasters. And they're kind of coming in similar because words like disaster, things like that are common in this space. Okay? So now you understand how to take 10 years of a news corpus and just see it in one shot, right? Now let's see what we can do with it. So if you're interested in this kind of thing, so let's say you are a government agency and you want to understand if Russia is, you know, so imagine you're doing this query, Russian proliferation of nuclear weapons to Iran, okay? So this is what the query is, and now the same space, and we highlight which is the region that highlights the maximum with this query. Same space. So remember, this part of the space was mass destruction and, you know, nuclear and all that. So this is where the query is, and there are some other hotspots all over the place. Understand? So what we've done, we have looked at, imagine now the web. all the web data on this two-dimensional surface. You type the word apple, and apple comes up in one part of the space, one part of the space, one part of the space, right? Three different meanings of the word apple, and different parts of the space highlight. Now you click on one of the cells, another layer opens up. Now you can do a visual. So imagine doing a visual search on that. Yeah.
So what is each cell?
It's a part of the meaning space. So imagine a 300-dimensional.
One cell means has one meaning.
One meaning as in, one region in the meaning. See, meaning is a very sort of fluid thing, right? So whatever it learned, based on that, it said, okay, all these guys went to this cell, and they're very close to each other, therefore they went to each other. It's just because it's a discretization of the continuous meaning space.
Okay.
Right? So it has to have some boundary and something might be next to it and all that. But meaning. Okay. So then if I click on it, I can say, oh, Russian deputy fears increased proliferation of WND, right? So this document belongs to this one. So not only words belong to each cell, but documents also belong to each cell. Right? So I can rank order the documents based on this thing, right? Sorted by this. Iraqi scientist reports on German and other things on chemical weapons. So there are, so it's a very visual way of doing exploration of your 10 years worth of news columns. Right? Alright. So let's see a lot more examples of this kind of thing. So this is scoring from text data. So this is another example from insurance companies. So insurance companies, what they do is, imagine if a Flipkart guy comes here to deliver a book and he slips because there is water on the floor and he hurts himself and he needs to go for surgery, who is going to pay for it? Is Flipkart going to pay for it or IIIT is going to pay for it? Right? This is called subrogation. So the two insurance companies say, no, you're going to pay for it, it's your fault. This guy says, no, you're going to pay for it, it's your fault. Right? So it's called a subrogation process. And if I look at a lot of text data, so whenever such things happen in insurance, they write down a bunch of text description of what happened. And we took that text data and we said, what kinds of things are there in the text data? Remember the first thing we talked about, lack of awareness. We don't know what we don't know. So we can't say that there are these five things in it. We don't know what we don't know. This is a very important idea, and that's what these visualizations are telling us. Right? So we don't know, so this guy came out with, there are names, generally there are names, a lot of names of people, right, name in common. Then there are muscle injuries, symptoms, bone and neck injuries, traffic and auto. So this region is very big. There are a lot of subrogations that happen, right? Always, it's the other guy's fault, right? If you have a traffic accident, subrogation is a very big deal in traffic and auto. Then, you know, food and bruises and cuts because somebody is cutting, you know, something at home and he hurt himself. So, can he sue you for that mistake, right? Eye injuries, slippery slopes, we talked about slippery slopes. So, that kind of space emerged from this visualization, right? And now, let me show you another beautiful overlay on top. This is what we call the scores. We actually built a prediction model that said, predict if this text will lead to subrogation or not, right? So the score is high if this text leads to subrogation. And now, each of the cell is color-coded with what is the probability that if you belong in this cell, you have a high probability of subrogation. Does that make sense? So it's a classification problem, two-class problem, and I can overlay the prediction on top of the space. And when I look at these two together, I kind of understand that this region is very hot, right? Auto and traffic. So let's look at some examples. So now I'm going to overlay one more thing on top of it. So not only I'm showing you the space, the meaning space of the whole corpus, I'm showing you the prediction output overlaid on the same space. Now I'm going to show you this query. So this query says, motor vehicle accident, next train, rear-ended by truck, pushed into ditch, hit by four others. Right? Pretty bad situation for this guy, and this query falls in this region of the space. You understand? So obviously it's going to have a very high subrogation score. So imagine you are a insurance agent who wants to decide this. If I show you this visualization, as you enter the text, I'm going to turn the region screen where your text belongs, and you can actually see whether it belongs on a hot region or a cold region. Right? Okay. Here is another query. Employee was cutting wood with saw wood. Chip went into eye. Whose fault is it? Right? It's not subrogation, right? The guy has to pay for his own insurance because it was his fault. So see, remember this eye injury? And this region was machinery and cuts and bruises. So this query fall in this region, and this is kind of a cold region for that kind of classification problem. So now you see how you can visualize the entire text space, overlay of the model, and overlay of the query on top. Any questions? Okay, I'll show you something even more interesting. This is an example from another banking application, which is collection note. So let's say you've not paid your bills for a while. The bank guys will call you and say, hey, what's happening and why are you not paying? And people are going to give one kind of excuse or the other, right? Now the banks don't know what to do with that data. So there's this guy who is typing this data, but they don't know what to do with it. So they said, can you do something with this data? So we said, okay, let's not assume anything. Let's look at the visualization, right? Same technique, same process. We created visualization. So we saw all these concepts in it. Forgot, mix-up, unreachable, confirmed payment, waiting for funds, account mix-up, you know, hospitalization, bankruptcy, not sufficient funds, financial difficulties, forgot out of town, right? So these are the kinds of things people are saying when people are calling for money, okay? So there is a structure to this space. There is no, it's not like randomly people are saying something. There's a whole structure to that space, and now we did something even more interesting, which is we said, okay, let's actually look at the probability of defaulting also. Along with the space, what they are saying, let's look at the hotspots. So here is another model that is meant to predict whether he will eventually pay or not. Right? So he's already late. Will he pay? Should I spend more resources on this person? Or should I give it to somebody else to collect the money or let it go? Or send a notice? What should I do with this guy? Right? So there is a model they have, and we say, let's overlay this model on top of this visualization and see what people are saying and what their score is. And it turns out that you know, there are different hotspots. It's not like a continuous one place hotspot. There are many, many reasons for what they are doing, and this is very much like the recommendation example we saw before. Remember recommendation engine? We said you can't depend on a score alone. You need to know what are the extra benefits from that decision. Here, again, if they depended just on the score, they will say if the score is above this number, do this action. If the score is above this number, do this action, right? That's a very bad idea, and for this reason, because different people have different reasons not to pay, right? So this guy is not paying because you are unable to reach, he's not picking up your phone. You have to take a different action. You can't keep calling him every 6 months. You have to send somebody, you send a letter, whatever, right? Go to his permanent address. So this part is different because unreachable. For this reason, this score is high. Here the score is high because of something else. He's waiting for funds. So it's kind of like medium. Maybe he'll get the fund, not get the fund. So the decision here could be, let's wait for some more time, right? Here the decision could be something else, right? So here, for example, this is not sufficient funds. He's out of money, he's out of job. So he's not able to pay. So the point of this slide is that score alone is not enough. You need to know why the score is high. And once you put these two together, the decisions will be different. You're going to take different decisions on different people. And you're not going to just say, score is this, do this. Understand? So that's a new insight that the banks got. Earlier they were just going with the score. And now when we put show this together, oh, then they revamp their whole strategy. And then they start to get better results. Hmm? Alright, so here's an example. Sending reaffirmation to attorney, mailing reaffirmation to attorney, court case still pending. So there's a court case pending, so unless that is resolved, he's not going to pay, so he's on a high risk area. And then this guy, you know, thought she already got caught up, she will transfer the money, had checking on Monday and make the payment, right? So this is kind of like in the waiting for, this is kind of that region which is I think forgot or behind and all that. So it falls here, so she's going to pay, won't do anything, right? So that's the idea that while you're talking on the phone, you can actually type this and it can show you where the thing falls and you can take the right decisions. Okay? Alright. So the last example of this on visualizing text data, this is on accident report. So imagine, you know, you have accidents in US, and every time there's an accident, the police comes then exchange insurance numbers and all that, but they'll also type a report. It says, you know, what was the car people were driving, right? What was the weather condition? Where did the accident happen? And a description of the accident. So the government was collecting this data for a long time, tens of years, collecting descriptions of accidents, but this is text data, they don't know what to do with it. They know what to do with the other things, right? Insurance field and phone number, they know what to do. Text data, they didn't know. So they gave us this data and said, can you do something? So we said, let's visualize it first. So here is a visualization of what is happening in the car world, accident world, right? So here you have concepts like tire size, tire brand, car model, mileage, smells and sounds, death and injury, chassis problem, brake problem, instrument gauge, engine failure, transmission. So these are the concepts in the in that kind of data, right? In the accident data. Now something very interesting happened, and I want to show you that, which is kind of which will tell you that if a human could actually be reading all these text data, they could have saved some lives. So here is an example. So this is what happened in August 2010, in 2000, which is, you know, Ford is a car maker, we all know, right? Ford used to use tires from this company called Firestone. And what happened was, in one of their tires, they were just randomly exploding. Somehow there was a fault in the tires, and these tires were exploding, and there were like people getting killed because of that, or accidents were happening, right? And in different parts of the company, country, in different places, this thing was happening. So nobody was looking at the big picture. Right? The guy just filled the report, he doesn't know that this thing is happening for a while. Right? Everybody is just filing reports. Nobody is looking at the big picture and doing analysis because it's all text data. We don't know what to do with it. Right? That kind of thing. So we said, let's look at this data and look at this thing in retrospect. So remember, this happened in August 2000. The news broke out in August 2000, but obviously the accidents were happening all over up to that point. So now we looked at this car, Ford Explorer 96. And we looked at the density map, which says how many reports in this month came on different cells of the thing, right? So we take a report and we put it on the map and it gives me a density map, right? Now observe this area for this car, see what is happening, March 99, right? I'm just going to do a run out. See how this area is becoming redder, right? More red. So this is by September 99, which is like almost a year before. There was evidence in the data that something is wrong with this car. More and more reports are coming in this area, tire building. Right? And if somebody was able to look at this visualization before, they would have been able to figure this out. And that is one of the problems, that when you don't see the data the way you could, then you land up losing a lot of things. Right? So the Ford had to get all the tires back and spend millions of dollars to recall all the tires, and a lot of money was spent, right? Now imagine doing this on other things. Like, let's say you're Boeing, you're doing a complex project, right? Building a new plane, and let's say you have all the email exchanges going on between project managers, right? And they're talking about different things. They're saying the parts is delayed from Australia, Taiwan, or whatever, and this guy's talking about something. Now imagine if somebody, single person, could read all that email and create this kind of visualization, right? So imagine the space could be like, hey, you know, delay in parts, or, you know, quality is poor, or whatever, right? So you can have this space, and as emails are coming up or discussions happening on the project, you can actually start to see the density, and somebody at the top of the project can look at this and say, you know, why don't we investigate something as emerging, right? Because individually people don't know, but the big picture has it. So our contention is the data as a whole has a lot of insights. We are behind in terms of finding. That is what we have learned. Okay? So, and you know, obviously as this goes on, you could actually find this almost a year before the whole thing happened. Okay? So that was my last slide. So let me talk about the three things that we need to think about when we do visualization. One is, what is the nature of my data? Is it image? Is it text? Is it gene sequences? Is it speech signals? All that stuff. What kind of distribution do I have, right? I mean, some data will have normal distribution, some will have different distribution. How high dimensional it is? Is it sparse or not, right? Text data is very sparse, gene sequences are very high dimensional, whatever, right? So you need to think about the nature of your data. Think about what kind of things you can do with this kind of data, right? Can you actually project using PCA? You can't project a gene sequence using PCA. You need to think of other techniques, right? All right. what kind of distance do I want to define? Remember the smell example? We said people can do distances. Similarly, in text, we saw distance as similarity between meanings, right? You can imagine distance between two people, you know, how much exchange of emails they do, how much they talk on the phone. Remember, you know, different companies can look at distance between people in different ways. So distance is a very important notion in visualization. We understand that, right? And then, what kind of insights you want to look at? Do I want to look at the big picture? What kind of, you know, things, do I want to visualize a decision? Do I want to visualize a model? So we saw examples of all that kind of visualizations, right? All right, so that's where I'll stop with the one part that is said. In the arrangement of the visualization, every single pixel should testify directly to content. All right, so I'll stop here if you have any questions.
I have a couple of questions.
Sure.
Fairly related actually.
Yeah.
This. If there are two visualizations for the same data,
right.
How do you figure out which is the best visualization? I mean, it is possible that you can give different inference.
Right.
So how do you figure out which is the best visualization?
Yeah, so there's no best. It all depends on what you want to see. So you can define best in so many ways. One is, you can say, is it losing anything? Am I losing something? Or is it complete? Is it giving me the complete structure? Or is it giving me partial structure? That's one abstract notion of what is best, right? Then relevance. Is it showing me something I care about? Or something that I don't care about, right? So in the financial world, for example, if it is just showing you that, hey, based on where people live, you know, that is the distance function, then it's not a useful visualization for you. But if it is based more on, you know, their credit score or whatever, right, their social score or social relationship, maybe that's more important, right? Let's say Twitter visualization, you're doing it on IP address proximity versus, you know, kinds of people they follow. So what dimensions you use and is it relevant to what work you want to do? So if Twitter wants to open a data center in some location, maybe they want to look at how many people are in different parts of the world. Maybe that is a good visualization for that problem. But if they want to do some other analysis on things and recommend people for following each other on Twitter, they may want to do a different visualization, right? So there is no one answer of this is the best visualization, but relevance, holistic nature, as in it doesn't miss anything, it shows you all possible angles. And obviously, how quickly can you get the right insight from it? I mean, is it taking you, you know, a little bit of time to understand, or you just see it and you know what it is, right? Like I showed you the visualization, once you understand what it means, you can immediately say, oh, that's what is happening there, right? So it should be user-friendly in that sense. If there is a dynamic to it, like I need to drill down on a place, go deeper in one area, or if I want to change the distance function on the fly, for example, right? So it changes the visualization quickly. If those kind of things are there. So those are what we would call good visualizations. But it all depends on the right choice of distance functions, which can be changing over time, depending on the application, and the completeness of the data, as in have you sampled the entire space, or are you only able to look at one part of the space, right? Don't miss anything, and show me what is relevant. Two things. Yes.
Sometimes it will happen that visualizing data actually leads to ambiguity in understanding a certain answer to a question as opposed to numbers given to the
numbers. Very good. So, my understanding from doing all this is ambiguity is not a result of, it is not inherent in the data, it is inherent in the limitation of the number of variables we have collected. So if there is a phenomena that is happening because of some variable which we have not collected, okay, then however we look at the visualization, we'll not be able to find out why these things are different. Right? Two things will look very similar to each other because the one thing that really mattered in the distinction of the two people was not present in the data. So in that case, you need to understand the completeness of the features you have collected. Or maybe you are using the wrong distance function, right? We said PCA versus Fisher, right? So if you are not projecting it correctly, you may not see the right things in the data. So therefore, it's an art and a science. it's an art. It really is. I mean, you need tools that can give you multiple perspectives, tools that can change the distance function, you can add new features to it. You know, you can work on a very large amount of data, you can sample it in a different way than the others. But the source of ambiguity and noise, I think, is never in the process that generated the data. It is always in the limited number of features we have collected and the smaller perspective with which we are looking at things.
So then you apply extra
features, collect more, yeah, additional features and do that, right? So for example, if you are looking at people's buying behavior, and you're only looking at their, you know, what they buy and what they bought before, that may give you only a limited perspective. But if you start collecting their demographics, right? Where do they live? How far do they live from the store? How many people are there in the family? Then you start to get additional input, which can give you better visualization of the same thing. So it's always about this. And I think if you look at the history of science, this is how the science has evolved. It started looking at a limited part of the universe, right? The one that we can touch and feel, so we know everything about it. We thought these were the laws of physics. When we started looking at the space or the quantum world, we realized those laws don't apply. So it's not like this theory was incomplete, it was complete with respect to the data that we saw. So when we started looking at this data and that data, now we say, okay, we need a bigger thing. So it's always like that. We are running behind truth, which is in a much higher dimensional space, and we have a very narrow view of it. And that's why we see things which look ambiguous or noisy. And I believe that probability theory was really invented to cover up this limitation. Right? That we are not able to completely understand that world. Right? That's why the CERN laboratory is trying to understand the Higgs boson by collecting so much data on it that we don't miss any perspective. Right? So that's generally good question. Okay? Any other questions? Yes?
Can visualization actually help us know that we have either too much or too less data?
There's no such thing as too much data, but surely it can. And the trick depends on sampling, really. I mean, I don't think today we have to worry about too less data. We have to really worry about too much data. And in that space, we need to worry about my sampling strategy. It needs to be correct. If I am going to do density-based sampling, I'm only going to look at data which is in the dense clouds. I'm not going to see the outliers, right? Like in the banking example, if most of the people are in the middle income group, and I sample based on that probability, most of my sample will come from there, and I'm not going to build the complete space. So sampling is one direction of completeness of the visualization. Am I sampling so that, you know, the distributions are honored? And the other is the dimensions, features. If I do both the things correctly, holistically, then I'm going to be, and the third is the distance function. Once we have sampled the features, how to weigh them. So if you do these three things right, you'll get a good picture.
So this
sounds
like a question.
Yes.
Is there an exhaustive list of different visualizations that are possible? And can they be mapped to a particular type of data? And if yes, why is it still an art? Because then it would be directly a science. You know you have a time-based data set, you have three different ways of visualizing it.
Right.
Why can't you just have some sort of a software? There are something like Tableau, but they don't recommend based on this data what we do.
Right.
So is there an exhaustive idea, or are there still newer ways of visualizing data that are still available?
See, it's a very creative field, right? So the more creative the field is, the more options you have, right? And yes, of course, there are, you know, if you give the same data to different designers, they'll come up with different visualizations. Not because, you give exactly the same data, same sample, same feature, same distance function, they'll still come up with different visualizations, right? So it's a creative process. It need not be constrained to five boxes. But yes, there are lots of visualization techniques for different types of data. See, when does something become an art? That is the question we should ask. When does something become an art, and when does it become a science, right? So there are all these algorithms, right? Clustering, let's say, projection methods. It becomes an art when you have to decide what the distance function should be. right? How do you tie that to your business problem? Then no machine learning or visualization method will not tell you what to do. You see, it's like a carpenter who knows all the tools, but there is a necessary idea of creativity, right? He can still create so many different things out of all the same tools. So that part is the art, the talent of the carpenter. So that's what is there, and I think, you know, you can think of it in terms of how do you choose your parameters, like how many clusters do you want to see. In our visualizations, you saw the text visualization, I use different number of clusters in different places. How do you choose that, right? So that is one example of an art, right? So you try different things and what makes sense. Too high resolution, too fine grained, people are not going to be able to consume it. Too coarse, it is losing too much information. So you make a decision on that. These are the kinds of things that make it an art process. It's not just about color scheme and this and that. It's about choices of parameters that help the visualization come to life. Right? So yeah, there is an exhaustive list. I'm sure, you know, there are faculties in different things, and there are books written on visualization, and there are courses, and now there are departments on visualization only. So I'm sure there's an exhaustive list we can find somewhere. But you come in as a carpenter who knows what visualization to use with what data and what business model. That's where the art is. Yes?
Sandbox that you showed, is there a reason why they didn't wrap around? As in,
Yeah. In reality, the space is spherical. But because, you know, we can't show it on a 2D map, otherwise we needed a dynamic thing, right? Imagine a sphere, you are inside it, and I could rotate it. That would have been the right way to do that.
Then you could employ something similar to what they do with maps, right?
Yes. So yeah, that would be the next evolution of this visualization. But the space is like that. Actually, in reality, what we see is that space. But we basically, like a map, right? You, when you have to put it on a textbook, you have to show a 2D version. But when you have a globe, you can show it there. So it depends on where you want to show that visualization.
But what is looking for spots? I mean, I can't visualize it right now, but how do you look for regions, and the red regions, which is supposed to wrap around like the two edges?
Right.
How do you look for that?
Yeah, I can't imagine, but you can just turn the thing and say, you know, like if I want to show you the India part of the globe, I just have to turn the part to your side, right? See, the wrapping is an artifact of the real space. But the limitation of the 2D visualization, unless we are in a spherical 3D virtual reality world, we have to do it that. So you just turn it around and say, show me the map. And that's how the globe we can see, right? It's the same thing, but yeah, your point is right that it's a spherical space.
So does it mean the left extreme point to the right extreme point?
Yes, the bottom to, yeah. Any other questions? So you guys are excited about visualization now? Huh? Start using it in your data understanding tool. Don't just start downloading SVM software and put it through the data. That's not the way data mining happens. Unless you understand something in the data, you can't be a good data scientist. All right, thank you.